Hello and welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The news articles along with the page numbers are displayed here for your convenience. The PDF link of the handwritten notes and timestamping of the discussed news articles are given in the description box and also in the comment section. Let's begin with the first news article analysis. This discussion is about the order of Andhra Pradesh High Court for reinstating the Andhra Pradesh State Election Commissioner. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. In this context, we'll discuss in detail about the State Election Commissioner and the eligibility criteria to be appointed as the State Election Commissioner and also the important aspects of the High Court judgment. See, in the month of April 2020, the Governor of Andhra Pradesh promulgated Andhra Pradesh Panchayat Raj Second Amendment Ordinance, and this ordinance amended Section 200 of AP Panchayat Raj Act of 1994, and it also framed the AP Panchayat Raj salaries and allowances, conditions of service, tenure of State Election Commissioner, Rules 2020. And these rules replace the existing 1994 rules. Therefore, after the amendment of Section 200, the eligibility criteria to be eligible for the appointment as State Election Commissioner has been modified. Know that previously an officer who was holding or had held an office not less than in the rank of Principal Secretary to the government could be appointed as the State Election Commissioner. But after the amendment, only a former judge of the High Court is eligible for the appointment as State Election Commissioner. As per the 2020 rules, the State Election Commissioner will hold the office for a term of 3 years and will be entitled to be considered for reappointment for another 3 years. In addition to these aspects, the 2020 rules also state that the incumbent State Election Commissioner shall cease to hold office with immediate effect from the date of promulgation of the ordinance. So, based on the changes made by the ordinance, the incumbent State Election Commissioner's term was prematurely terminated and his tenure was to end after 5 years of appointment in 2021 only. But due to the ordinance, he was forcefully made to vacate the office through a government order. Then immediately a former judge of the Madras High Court was appointed as the new State Election Commissioner for the state of Andhra Pradesh. And this ordinance was challenged before the Andhra Pradesh High Court. So what triggered the promulgation of such an ordinance? It is allegedly said that the postponement of elections to the village panchayats by the then State Election Commissioner triggered this move. The then State Election Commissioner, Dr. N. Ramesh Kumar, postponed the elections to the village panchayats by 6 weeks, citing the prevailing situation because of the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic. So it was alleged that in this backdrop, the State Election Commissioner was prematurely terminated by the government of Andhra Pradesh State, and now the High Court of Andhra Pradesh has ordered for his reinstatement based on the constitutional provisions. Now let us discuss the important constitutional provisions regarding the State Election Commissioner. We know that as per Part 9 and Part 9A, the power for conducting elections to panchayats and municipalities has been given to the State Election Commission under Articles 243K and 243ZA of Indian Constitution, and such powers are exercised by the State Election Commissioner who is appointed by Governor. Furthermore, Article 243K Clause 2 mentions that the conditions of service and tenure of the office of the State Election Commissioner may be subject to the provisions of any law made by the state legislature, or otherwise it shall be as such the rules determined by the Governor. So, as per the same provision, that is for the removal of a State Election Commissioner, the procedure as prescribed for the removal of judge of High Court is to be followed. And this procedure is specified in Article 217 Clause 1, read with Article 124 Clause 4 of the Indian Constitution. Know that the High Court judge can be removed only by an order of President based on a motion passed by both the Houses of the Parliament with 2/3 of the majority of the members present and voting, only on the grounds of proved misbehavior or incapacity. So, we can say that it guarantees security of tenure to the appointed State Election Commissioner. Likewise, Article 243K seeks to extend the security of tenure to the State Election Commissioner. This allows State Election Commissioner to act independently and without the fear of dismissal for taking decisions that may not favor the executive. So based on these provisions, State Election Commissioner was reinstated by the High Court, stating that the Rules 2020 will be applicable in prospective manner but not in the retrospective manner. So subsection 5 of section 200 of AP Panchayat Raj Act was held arbitrary, unreasonable, discriminatory and unconstitutional, as it mentioned that any person appointed as State Election Commissioner and hold office as such shall cease to hold office. So it provides for statutory friction as a State Election Commissioner was not removed as per the provisions of Article 243K. Further, the High Court of Andhra Pradesh held that the power exercised by the governor is not based on the satisfaction of the circumstances existed, which is mandated by the Article 213 of the Indian Constitution. It did not seem necessary for the governor to take immediate action in the public interest or in the constitutional necessity. So the High Court of Andhra Pradesh struck down the ordinance, saying that the promulgation was actuated or motivated by oblique reasons and on extraneous or irrelevant grounds. And the High Court has directed the government of Andhra Pradesh to reinstate the removed State Election Commissioner, Dr. N. Ramesh Kumar, with immediate effect. However, the government of Andhra Pradesh is considering all the possible options to challenge the High Court judgment in the Supreme Court. In this context, in the coming days, we may have the relevant editorials or associated news articles in the coming days. But for our exam point of view, try to remember the constitutional provisions or the constitutional safeguards available to the State Election Commissioner in order to conduct free and fair elections to the local bodies in their respective states. With this information, we'll discuss the displayed practice question at the end of the session. Let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article is based on the widening fiscal deficit of our country. In this contest, we'll discuss the terms like fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, effective revenue deficit, and then primary deficit, and know that these terms are very important for your prelims examination. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. To understand these terms like fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, we must understand union budget in brief. That is, as per Article 112, the union government is responsible to present the union budget every year. And this article states that the President of India shall, in respect of every financial year, cause to be laid before both the Houses of Parliament a statement of the estimated receipts and expenditure of the Government of India for that financial year. Know that the union budget is presented in two accounts, that is, revenue accounts and the capital accounts. The revenue account includes revenue receipts and revenue expenditure, whereas the capital account includes the capital receipts and the capital expenditure. The receipts, like taxable as well as non-taxable revenues, are included in the revenue receipts, whereas in case of capital receipts, it includes all those receipts of the government which create liability or reduces its financial assets are included in this capital receipts. So we can say that in case of capital receipts, the main items are market borrowings, including borrowings from the public, then borrowing by the Government of India from the Reserve Bank of India. Now, if you look at the revenue expenditure, it includes the expenditure incurred for different purposes other than the creation of physical or financial assets of the central government. So we can say that revenue expenditure indicates day-to-day administration expenses of the central government, whereas the capital expenditure includes expenditures of the government which results in the creation of physical or financial assets or expenditure that may reduce the financial liabilities of the government. Therefore, when a government spends more than it collects, it leads to deficit budgeting, and there are various measures that captures different types of deficits. And these deficits are known as revenue deficit, effective revenue deficit, primary deficit, and then fiscal deficit. So let us understand revenue deficit, which refers to the excess of government's revenue expenditure over the revenue receipts. So when the government incurs a revenue deficit, it clearly implies that the government is dis-saving. That is, it is using up the savings of the other sectors of the economy to finance its consumption expenditure. In this context, we must also discuss effective revenue deficit. Know that it is a new term introduced in the Union Budget 2011-12 to indicate the difference between revenue deficit and the grants for the creation of capital assets. So we can say that effective revenue deficit indicates revenue deficit after deducting the grants for the creation of capital assets. Now, let us understand one more term, that is fiscal deficit, which is the difference between the government's total expenditure and its total receipts excluding borrowings. So we can say that the gross fiscal deficit indicates the total expenditure over its revenue receipts and then non-debt creating capital receipts. Know that non-debt creating capital receipts are those receipts which are not borrowings and don't give rise to debt. And these receipts do not create additional debt. The examples for the non-debt creating capital receipts include the recovery of loans and then the proceeds from the selling of the shares of central public sector enterprises that we call the proceeds from the disinvestments. Now let us understand one more term, that is a primary deficit, which simply indicates the fiscal deficit minus the interest payments. See, the borrowing requirement of the government includes interest obligations on the accumulated debt. Therefore, the goal of measuring primary deficit is to focus on present fiscal imbalances. So, gross primary deficit is equal to the gross fiscal deficit minus net interest liabilities. Know that the net interest liabilities consists of interest payments minus interest receipts by the Government of India on net domestic lending. With this information, let's take up the given news article, which reports that the total receipts of the government were at about 17.5 lakh crores and the total expenditure was at 26.86 lakh crores. As a result of total expenditure exceeding the total receipts, the fiscal deficit has widened to about 4.6% of the GDP in the financial year 2019-20. And it is much higher than the revised estimate of 3.8% for that fiscal year. And this is mainly because of the shortfall in the revenue collections. The news article also says that the revenue deficit was at 3.27% and the effective revenue deficit was at 2.36%. To conclude this news article, try to remember that the various definitions given for the fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, effective revenue deficit, and then the primary deficit. With this information, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This Ground Zero article presents the ground realities of destruction caused by super cyclone Ampan. In the analysis of this news article, we'll discuss in brief about this cyclone. However, our focus will be mainly on the impact of the cyclone caused by the different agents of destruction in a tropical cyclone. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this article is highlighted here for your reference. Cyclone Ampan is a tropical cyclone that was formed over Bay of Bengal and it was described by Indian Meteorological Department as a super cyclone. This is because the wind speed associated in the circulation of the cyclone was 221 km per hour or more. And then on 18th May, IMD reported that Ampan has become a severe intense cyclone with associated wind speed of 220 to 230 km per hour at the sea. And this was the scenario before it made landfall in the West Bengal coast. And then on 20th May 2020, that is in the evening of this date, Ampan crossed West Bengal Bangladesh coast as a very severe cyclonic storm with a speed of 155 to 165 km per hour, gusting to 185 km per hour across the Sundarbans. It has caused severe and unimaginable damage in the state of West Bengal, particularly in the southern part of West Bengal, as you can see in this picture. The article reports that in anticipation of the cyclonic storm, about 5 lakh people were evacuated to cyclone shelters, and this includes about 3 lakh people from South 24 Parganas district. While evacuating people, the government authorities faced a serious challenge. This is because of ongoing COVID-19 crisis. See, certain shelters were earmarked for quarantine facility of COVID-19 patients, and in one or more instances, the cyclone evacuees and those who had been in quarantine had to be kept under one roof. Now let us see the various dimensions of the destruction caused by the cyclone Ampan. Know that around 98 persons died because of the cyclone. And other than the loss of lives, the cyclone is known for the vast destruction to the environment and also to the property. It destroyed thousands of homes. It broke the embankments in island areas and nearby the rivers. This has led to the incursion of saline water because of storm surge. This has also led to flooding into the villages that washed away several homes. Acres and acres of agricultural lands were flooded, and the time was to harvest rabi crops cultivated with the toil of last few months were also destroyed by this cyclone. It is reported that by one of the estimates, lakhs of sharecroppers of southwest Bengal had lost their produce. Vegetables and cash crops like sesame, jute and fruit were washed away as a result of flooding. In some regions of the Sundarbans, yellow lentils or moong dal is cultivated here, and the sowing was delayed because of cyclone Bulbul, which struck West Bengal on 9th November 2019, and just before the harvest, cyclone Ampan washed away thousands of acres of plantation, and this has resulted into tremendous loss for the farmers. In lot of islands and other regions, tourism sector is heavily affected, and for some of the local population, tourism is an alternative livelihood option. So many have invested in building seaside homes for tourists, and in this picture you can see a seaside homes in Mausuni Island, and know that the Mausuni Island is located close to Sagar Island in the mouth of Hooghly River. And the news article reports that almost all the seaside homes were destroyed in this island. We know that COVID-19 pandemic has imposed restrictions for tourists not to visit such tourist locations. In addition to this, the Ampan cyclone completely washed away these seaside homes. Therefore, it is a severe blow to those who invested in the tourism sector. In addition to these damages, the cyclone has uprooted several trees and lamp posts. And the news article reports that in Kolkata, which is the capital city of West Bengal, was completely battered. The article adds that in case of Kolkata, trees and electric poles uprooted in every lane in the ever neighborhood. And this has made the restoration of essential infrastructure services as a gigantic and monumental task for the civic authorities. At one point of time, the Ground Zero article mentions that three factors will cause severe damages with reference to a tropical cyclone. And now we'll discuss about these three factors related to a tropical cyclone. And know that these are the three important elements associated with a tropical cyclone which cause destruction during its occurrence. Gale winds refer to very strong high-speed winds. These high-speed strong winds cause severe damage to infrastructure, and these very strong winds accompanying a cyclonic storm can cause damages to installations, dwellings, communication systems, including the nature. And know that there are two categories in these high-speed winds. They are gust and the squalls. Gusts are short rapid bursts in wind speed. Squalls are longer periods of increased wind speed. Squalls are generally associated with the bands of thunderstorms that make up the spiral bands around the cyclone. Now we'll see the second factor associated with the tropical cyclones, that is torrential rains and inland flooding. Torrential rainfall more than 30 centimeters per hour associated with the cyclones is another cause of damages, and this rainfall causes unprecedented flooding and can cause large-scale soil erosion and also weakening of embankments. Then the third factor is storm surge. Know that a storm surge is an abnormal rise of sea level near the coast caused by a tropical cyclone. As a result of storm surge, seawater floods low-lying areas of coastal regions, and this causes drowning of human beings and livestock and can also erode beaches and embankments. They also destroy vegetation and leads to destruction of soil fertility. So these are the main agents of destruction in a tropical cyclone that we have discussed in the context of this news article. Now, while Ampan has devastated southern part of West Bengal, we should note that Ampan is not the last cyclone. This means that we need a specific reason. Now, we'll discuss what is the need of the day to mitigate or to prepare effectively for such large scale destructive tropical cyclones. We know that the super cyclone Ampan has devastated southern part of West Bengal and also some parts of Odisha. We should also note that Ampan is not the last cyclone that has devastated the coastal districts. This means that we need a region-specific, situation-specific, comprehensive mitigation plan to respond to such events in the future. Such a mitigation policy or plan should have inclusive mechanisms for risk minimization, resilience building, and then for effective preparedness in order to reduce or to minimize the loss of lives and the property. The news article concludes with the note that it is a time to evaluate the state's preparedness and the fragility of our urban infrastructure, and this evaluation is required to prepare adequately to prevent and minimize such damages if the state is to face such challenges from the nature in the future. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to the next news article analysis. This practice model prelims question framed on the GST Council. And the background for this question is that the news article reports that Goods and Services Tax Council is likely to meet in the month of June. Know that there were repeated demands from the states for the GST Council meeting because GST compensation dues are pending since December 2019. GST revenue data, which is usually released on monthly basis, also withheld till the month of July 2020. It is because the deadline to file GST returns has been extended to 30th June 2020 because of ongoing lockdown. In this context, let us understand about GST Council, its composition, and some of the important functions of this council. Know that GST Council is a constitutional body, and we know that GST was introduced by the 101st Constitutional Amendment Act 2016. And as per this amendment, new destination-based indirect tax system, that is GST, was introduced. It also made a constitutional provision for the establishment of GST Council. And this council makes recommendations to the union and also to the state governments on variety of issues related to goods and services tax. The GST Council is chaired by the Union Finance Minister, and the other members of this council include the Union State Minister of Revenue or Finance and ministers in charge of finance or taxation of all the states. Know that the composition of the council is according to the Article 279A Clause 2. Now we'll see the functions of this GST Council. That is, the council shall make recommendations to the union and the states on different issues such as issues related to the taxes, cesses and surcharges that is levied by the center, states and also by the local governments which may be subsumed under the GST tax regime. Next, it will also recommend model GST laws, principles of levy, apportionment or allocation of integrated GST, that is IGST, and also the principles that govern the place of supply. We know that GST is a destination-based indirect tax, that is, the goods or services will be taxed at the place where they are consumed but not at the source of origin. So the state where they are consumed will have the right to collect GST. So this in turn makes the concept of place of supply, which is crucial under GST, as all the provisions of GST revolves around the place of supply of goods. The GST Council also recommends the threshold limit of aggregate turnover, and this limit determines the type of goods or services may be exempted from the GST tax. then it also recommends any special rate which is to raise additional resources during any natural calamity or disaster, etc. Know that these recommendations or recommendations given by GST Council are only in advisory nature but not binding on either on union government or on the state governments. With this information, let's take up the given question. Here three statements are given with reference to Goods and Services Tax Council, and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 is incorrect because it is a constitutional body established as per the constitutional provisions of 101st Constitutional Amendment Act of 2016. The second statement is also incorrect because it recommends to the union government and also to the state governments on issues related to goods and service tax. The third statement is also incorrect because it is chaired by the Union Finance Minister. So the correct answer for this question is option D, none of the above. This question is based on locust, and we have been discussing about locust search in different parts of India. Today also we have different news articles based on the concerns raised against the locust swarms in various parts of India. And know that we have elaborately discussed about the locust attack in our 23rd May 2020 and also on 26th December 2019. And you can refer these videos for complete understanding about locust swarms. In today's discussion, we'll discuss in brief about desert locust, mainly in prelims perspective. Know that the desert locust is scientifically known as Cystocerca gregaria, and it is one of the most harmful insects in the world. Locust species are members of the grasshopper family Acridiidae. They are highly migratory in nature and they have voracious feeding behavior. Under favorable ecological conditions such as heavy rainfall, adult locusts may congregate or form swarms. And these locust swarms may contain millions of individuals, which may cause great devastation to natural and cultivated vegetation. So they have the potential to threaten food security of the affected area. With this information, now let us understand in brief about the breeding seasons of locust. That is, in general, locusts have three breeding seasons. They are winter breeding, that is from November to December, then spring breeding to June months, and then summer breeding season, that is from July to October month. India has only one locust breeding season, that is the summer breeding season from July to October month. And know that our neighboring country Pakistan has two breeding seasons, that is spring and summer breeding seasons. In our 23rd May 2020 video, we have discussed desert locust invasion in Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh states. We have also said that Malathion, which is an insecticide, can be effectively used against desert locust. In this context, we should also understand about the Locust Warning Organization, which was established in response to a desert locust plague during 1926 to 1931. The then British government established the Locust Warning Organization in 1939 with its headquarters at Karachi, which is located in the present-day Pakistan. Know that the present Locust Warning Organization has its headquarters at Jodhpur in the state of Rajasthan, and it is headed by a Plant Protection Advisor, and this organization comes under the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation in the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. And this organization gives warnings about the possibility of a locust swarm incursion and their movement and also their breeding. With this information, let's take up the given question. Here two statements are given and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says summer breeding, that is from July to October, of the locust has great potential to threaten food security in India. And this statement is correct because in general, locusts have three breeding seasons, like winter breeding, spring breeding, and then summer breeding. India has only one locust breeding season, that is summer breeding season, from the month of July to October month. If you look at the second statement, it says that the Locust Warning Organization, which gives warnings about the possibility of locust swarm incursion, movement and breeding, functions under the National Disaster Management Authority. This statement is incorrect because though the function of Locust Warning Organization is correct, but it comes under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So the correct answer for this question is option A, one only. Let's take up this question, that is, which of the following dams or projects are located in the state of Telangana? The background for this question is that the state of Telangana has operationalized the Kaleshwaram lift irrigation project. In this context, the Chief Minister of Telangana has mentioned that within 6 years of the formation of the state of Telangana, the state has expanded its storage capacity of water, which has led to the addition of about 165 TMC feet of water to the existing storage capacity of the state. Even he has cited that the Telangana state has provided about 63% of the national food grains, which was revealed by the Food Corporation of India. In this context, know that the Kaleshwaram lift irrigation project is considered as one of the lifelines to the people of the Telangana state. With this information, let's take up the given question, that is, which of the following dams or project are located in the state of Telangana? Know that the Kaleshwaram lift irrigation project is constructed across the Godavari River in the state of Telangana, whereas Nizam Sagar project is also located in the state of Telangana, and it is also reservoir constructed across the Manjira River, which is the right bank tributary of Godavari River. Know that the Polavaram project and the Srisailam project are located in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Polavaram project, which is a multi-purpose project and also declared as a national project, is constructed across the Godavari River, whereas the Srisailam project, which is also multi-purpose project, is constructed across the Krishna River in the Kurnool district of Andhra Pradesh. So the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 3 only. Now let's take up this news article, which reports that Bank of India, which is one of the public sector banks in our country, has decided to reduce marginal cost of funds based lending rate, that is MCLR, by about 25 basis points across all tenors. The bank has also said that with this move, the bank has passed on the benefit of rate cut announced by RBI on 22nd May to its customers. In this context, we should know about MCLR because in 2016 UPSC prelims examination, there was a question on marginal cost of funds based lending rate. Know that MCLR was introduced by RBI with effect from April 2016, and it was part of monetary transmission, which is a qualitative measure of the impact of central bank's policy decisions on the banking system. That is, whenever the RBI reduces the policy rates, for example, if RBI reduces the repo rate, then the banks are expected to pass on the benefit of rate cut to their customers. Therefore, in order to bring transparency and accountability in the banking system, Reserve Bank of India has operationalized MCLR, and MCLR includes various important components like operating expenses, cost of maintaining cash reserve ratio, then the marginal cost of funds, for example, cost of borrowings by the banks, then also based on the loan tenure and commitments. So these components are included in the MCLR estimation by the respective banks before passing on the benefit of a policy rate cut by the Reserve Bank of India. So any change in repo rate will also be reflected in the lending rates. With this information, let's take up the given question, which is based on MCLR. Here two statements are given and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says these guidelines help to improve the transparency in the methodology followed by banks for determining the interest rates on advances. Then the second statement says these guidelines help to ensure availability of bank credit at interest rates which are fair to the borrowers as well as the banks. Here both the statements are correct with reference to MCLR. So the correct answer for this question is option C. This question is framed with reference to this news article. Reports that Major Suman Gawani of the Indian Army was awarded a prestigious UN award. This prestigious award is called as the UN Military Gender Advocate of the Year Award. In this context, it is important for us to know about this award. Rarely, Union Public Service Commission asks questions on prizes and awards. If you could notice, in the year 2015, UPSC asked Indira Gandhi Prize for Peace, Disarmament and Development for the year 2014 was given to which one of the following? The correct answer for this question is Indian Space Research Organization. On a similar note, try to know that the United Nations Military Gender Advocate of the Year Award recognizes the dedication and the effort of an individual peacekeeper in promoting certain principles. These are principles within the UN Security Council Resolution 1325, and this resolution was adopted in the year 2000 by the UN Security Council. This resolution reaffirms the important role of women when it comes to various domains of peacekeeping. It stresses the importance of equal participation and full involvement of women in all efforts for the maintenance and promotion of peace and security. It also urges all sectors to increase the participation of women and to incorporate gender perspectives in all the United Nations peace and security missions. So, in the selection process for this award, the United Nations Department of Peacekeeping Operations receives the nominations from the force commanders and heads of mission of all UN peacekeeping missions. They will nominate a military peacekeeper who had best integrated a gender perspective into peacekeeping activities. Know that Major Suman Gawani of the Indian Army has served as a military observer in the United Nations mission in South Sudan, that is UN MISS, from November 2018 to December 2019. She has earned international recognition for her significant role as the principal focal point of contact for gender issues in the mission. She has also visited various mission team sites across South Sudan to integrate gender perspective into the planning and military activity in the mission. So, to recognize her significant efforts, this award was conferred on 29th May 2020. Know that every year, 29th May is commemorated by the United Nations as International Day of UN Peacekeepers, and the theme of this year's commemoration is Women in Peacekeeping, a Key to Peace. This day is commemorated because it was the day in 1948 that the first UN peacekeeping mission began its operations in the Middle East. With this information, let's take up the given question. Here two statements are given and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says the International Day of United Nations Peacekeepers is observed in the month of May every year. And this statement is correct because 29th May is celebrated as the International Day of United Nations Peacekeepers. In 2020, for the first time, an Indian has received the UN Military Gender Advocate of the Year Award. This statement is also correct because for the first time, Major Suman Gawani of the Indian Army was awarded a prestigious United Nations Military Gender Advocate of the Year Award. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Let's take up practice prelims and mains questions. Consider the following statements with reference to Constitution of India. The superintendent's direction and control of conduct of elections to the state legislatures, panchayats and municipalities is vested in State Election Commission. The State Election Commissioner shall not be removed from the office except in like manner and on the like grounds as a judge of a High Court. Of the given statements, you need to choose incorrect statements. The first statement is incorrect because State Election Commission conducts elections to the panchayats and municipalities, whereas the Election Commission of India conducts elections to the Office of President, to the Office of Vice President, and also to the Parliament and the State Legislatures. The second statement is correct because as per the Article 243K Clause 2, the State Election Commissioner is safeguarded with the security and the safety of his tenure, and he shall not be removed from his office except in like manner and also on the like grounds as a judge of a High Court. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. Let's take up this question, which is based on effective revenue deficit and primary deficit. Statement 1 says effective revenue deficit indicates the difference between revenue deficit and grants for the creation of capital assets. The second statement says primary deficit is the difference between the government's total expenditure and its total receipts excluding borrowings. In the context of this question, know that the terms like fiscal deficit, revenue deficit, then effective revenue deficit, and also the primary deficit. Whenever the government's expenditure is more than its revenues, then it may lead to deficit budgeting. And the revenue deficit is defined as excess revenue expenditure over its revenue receipts. So we can say that revenue deficit indicates inability of the government to meet its day-to-day expenditure. Know that effective revenue deficit was introduced in the Union Budget 2011-12, and it indicates the difference between revenue deficit and the grants for the creation of capital assets. So the given first statement is correct. Know that gross fiscal deficit indicates excess total expenditure over its total receipts excluding borrowings. So we can say that fiscal deficit indicates total borrowings of the government. And if you deduct interest payments, that is net interest liabilities, from the fiscal deficit, you'll be left with primary deficit. So the goal of measuring primary deficit is to focus on present fiscal imbalances. Therefore, the given second statement is incorrect because the difference between the government's total expenditure and its total receipts excluding borrowings indicates the fiscal deficit but not the primary deficit. For this question, you have to choose incorrect statements. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now, let's take up one practice mains question which is relevant in General Studies Paper 1. Discuss the role played by the elements associated with tropical cyclones that cause destruction during their occurrence. This is a 10 marks question and you have to write in 150 words. And we request you to post your written answers in the comment section. And for those posted written answers, we'll give suitable feedback within the reasonable time frame. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of today's Indian newspaper. If you like the video, please do like, share, comment and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil services examination. Thank you.